Good afternoon. Education Finance Committee will come to order. Let's see, Representative Marquardt, studiously looking at the minutes, I see.
Madam Chair, so move the minutes.
All right. Representative Marquardt moves the adoption of the minutes of March 21st. Any questions or discussion? Seeing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Minutes are approved. Thank you, Representative Marquardt. All right, so members, the delete all amendment to House File 890, so the omnibus budget proposal is in your packets, and we are getting, is it the spreadsheets? Yeah, the spreadsheets are being duplicated right now, and will come up just as soon as they're ready. And so what I'd like to do is just, I'm not going to formally move the DE now, but we'll just talk about it. But this is the document that amendments will be drafted to. So this is the formal one. I'll just wait to actually do the moving of it on Friday when we meet. And so we'll have nonpartisan staff. We'll start with Ms. Para to walk through each of the provisions of the bill. And I would imagine Ms. Adrians will be here shortly with the spreadsheet, and then we'll go through that. And questions and discussion. Representative Dabney.
Just for everyone's understanding, then, what is your intended deadline for submission of amendments?
I believe we had said noon, 1 o'clock. I have to go double check. Whatever I said yesterday, I think it was.
Is that reflected in the notes I just or the minutes I just voted on?
Yes, exactly. I think it was noon. Let me double check. Does it say?
No, I didn't.
Okay. Well, no. So let's say noon, and I'll double check. If I said 1 o'clock, we'll check the tape. Then it's 1 o'clock.
Okay, very good.
Thank you. I should have written that down. Thank you for asking. All right. Any other procedural questions? Okay. And members, and I will say, because several other committees are also marking up their bills on Friday, I know I had hoped to move it earlier. But tax committee is marking up at 9 o'clock, so we're going to stick with our 10 o'clock time frame for Friday. And I apologize for any inconvenience to members, but there's several members on this committee, including the chair, who serve on taxes. So, Representative Murphy.
Madam Chair, that's okay with me because I've got stuff in the tax bill
too. Okay. All right. Thank you. Thank you. Okay. So, so we'll stick with that plan, and hopefully that'll work out for everybody in the end. And I know these things get a little crazy with multiple committees marking up the same time, and we'll just do the best we can to accommodate that. So, all right, Ms. Para, if you are ready, I think we'll have you go ahead and walk through the bill summary and the provisions. And I think you all should have a copy of that in your packets or at your place. Ms. Para.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And actually, Mr. Strom and I split up the article, so he'll be starting us off with Article 1.
Perfect. Very good. Mr. Strom.
Madam Chair, members, thank you. And questions at the end of each article or at the end of the document? What's your preference?
How about the end of each article?
Madam Chair, very good. In front of you, members, you should have the delete all amendment labeled A17-0268 in the right-hand corner, and a House Research bill summary for House File 890, the delete all amendment. I'll primarily be working off of the bill summary, but hopefully the two will align. First article in the bill is general education revenue, and there's a number of provisions in here that are from House File 1376. The first two provisions have to do with the asthma inhalers. These are as they were in Representative Erickson's bill when it came to this committee. The third and fourth sections of this article are for Representative News bill, having to do with the non-public textbook aid. In Section 3, multi-year subscriptions are authorized. No change to the aid amount, but as an allowable use, the non-public schools could request a multi-year subscription. In Section 4, other software, the definition of software or other educational technology is broadened to include the registration portion of an advanced placement course taken online. Section 5 is the provision related to non-public pupil aid. When Ms. Adrians comes, we'll walk through the spreadsheets, and you'll see these items for the dollar amounts that are included with each. Currently, non-public pupil aid is linked to the basic formula allowance, and as that allowance goes up, the non-public pupil aid also goes up. In this section, the provision is being delinked from the formula allowance, so it would no longer vary as the formula allowance changes. Section 6 is just a simple definitional matter from House File 1376. Section 7 is delinking the non-public pupil transportation aid from the increases in the general education formula allowance. Section 8 and 10 go together, and these are the sections from Representative Baker regarding the care and treatment facilities in the Wilmer School District that this committee heard about. Section 8 is a cross-reference link, and then Section 10 is the provision that authorizes the extended time for the programs at Prairie Lakes and Lake Park. Section 9 is the basic formula allowance increase. In this bill, the formula allowance goes up by 1.5%, or $91 per pupil in both the first and second year of the biennium. Section 11 is the compensatory revenue provision. There are three changes to compensatory revenue. The first is the existing formula is delinked from the formula allowance so that future increases in the formula allowance would not affect that amount. The second part is that the pilot grant sites that this committee heard about when Superintendent Law and others testified are added as an ongoing element of compensatory revenue. They're added at their base level, plus for the next 5 years, 75% of the amount that they got over base in fiscal year 2017. That's about $2.3 million per year was the base, and another roughly $4 million for each of the subsequent 5 years. The third change to compensatory revenue is creating a new component that we'll talk about in a moment called targeted compensatory revenue. We'll talk about that in just a moment. Section 12 is essentially the mechanism this committee has used over the last number of years to keep the overall levies unchanged from the estimate for that year, essentially at the baseline level. When we get to later in the bill, we'll see some changes primarily due to the elimination of the voluntary pre-kindergarten program that changed the overall levy, and by changing the operating capital levy by the same amount the other levies change, this keeps that neutral from a levy perspective. Section 13, as I mentioned, was the third component of the changes to compensatory revenue. A new ongoing statutory component is created called targeted compensatory revenue. It's set at $11 million statewide for fiscal, I have a typo here, for fiscal year 18 on the summary, if you'd be so kind as to change that, and at $15 million per year for fiscal years 2019 and later. The way this revenue works, it's distributed on a non-concentration basis, so it's the number of free plus one-half, the number of reduced-priced eligible students at each site. The $11 million is divided by the number of compensatory students, which is about 300,000 currently. For fiscal year 19, that's about $50 per free and reduced lunch under this formula. And then that revenue at the site level is further adjusted by the MCA, the Minnesota Comprehensive Assessments participation rate. For those districts with a participation rate of 95% or lower, the amount is adjusted down by the proportional amount that the participation rate is below that. This is an ongoing provision, will be part of general education, and the funding for it will show up in the general education lines on Ms. Adrian's spreadsheet. Section 14 is a provision from the House File 1376 that was part of the governor's bill. That provision was heard in Representative Erickson's committee and then introduced as a separate bill and sent off to GovOp because of its rulemaking in it, or lack thereof. The provision essentially authorizes MDE to set timelines and other things as part of its audit procedure without going through the formal rulemaking process to do so. Section 15 is from House File 1376 and simply adjusts the payment for the non-operating aids. Instead of those being paid over 12 equal monthly payments, they're concentrated in the first half of the year in 6 monthly payments so that they align with the bond schedules that districts generally face. Section 16 is some modifications to the language in House File 149 that Representative Erdahl brought to this committee, having to do with a school finance working group. The provision in the bill establishes a legislative study group to study the same kinds of issues that Representative Erdahl wished to have discussed. Section 17 is the levy adjustment that Representative Grossel brought to the committee for the Nevis School District. Section 18 is the appropriations section, and Ms. Adrians, when she walks through the spreadsheets, will talk about the appropriations. And Section 19 is, again, from House File 1376 and is the repealer of a definition that's no longer used of American Indian child. And Madam Chair, that's a quick summary of Article 1.
All right. Any questions for Mr. Strom on Article 1? Representative Dabney.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And a question for Mr. Strom. Article 1, Sections 4 and 7, the delinking of non-public pupil aid and delinking of non-public pupil transportation aid. Just wanting to understand, does that reduction in funding to traditional public schools, Representative Erickson walked us through this last week, does that in any way relieve the school districts of that responsibility, or are we simply providing them with less money to carry out that responsibility? Can you help me understand?
Mr. Strom.
Madam Chair, Representative Dabney, half and half. On the non-public pupil textbook aid, that amount essentially is limited in statute by the amount available, so that would reduce the obligation of the school district to pay that money to the non-public. On the transportation provision, there's a separate statute that requires the school district, it's called the Equal Treatment Statute, named that in statute, and it requires the transportation services to be provided regardless of whether they're fully funded or not. The formula that we have in place for non-public pupil transportation currently covers part of that cost. The school district has the same obligations to provide that that transportation service regardless of the funding or the increase in funding.
All right. Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you.
Thank you. Other questions on Article 1? Additional questions? No? Okay. All right. I think we can move on to the next article then. Ms. Vera?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Article 2 is education excellence. This article modifies provisions related to education excellence and provides grant aid funding for some programs. Section 1 of the article adds instruction in citizenship and economics to the list of subject areas for compulsory instruction. Sections 2 and 3 go together. These relate to instruction on days of inclement weather. So Section 2 allows school boards to include plans for up to 5 days of instruction through online instruction on these days. And Section 3, those are the e-learning days. It defines an e-learning day as a day where a school can offer instruction through online instruction. It allows the schools to adopt these plans after consulting with teachers, and it contains notice provisions and requires teachers to be accessible on these days. Section 4 modifies the academic standards by modifying the physical education standards. This was from House File 1376, and it also pulls in a provision from House File 1680, allowing a school district to include sexual health instruction in a health curriculum. I'm sorry, sexual abuse prevention instruction in a health curriculum. Section 5 eliminates obsolete language, stating when language arts, mathematics, arts, etc., these standards must be implemented. Section 6, this is from House File 1376, provides that seals that recognize high school students' proficiency, those apply to school districts, charter schools, as well as non-public schools. Section 7 requires a school district to identify students in grades 3 or higher who have difficulty reading and report on the school's efforts to identify students with dyslexia using screening tools identified by the Department of Education. Section 8 requires school districts to continue reading interventions after the third grade until the student is reading at grade level. Section 9 requires the Department of Education to employ its dyslexia and literacy specialist to help schools address the needs of students with dyslexia and related disorders. Section 10 encourages districts to train district staff and school board members. Section 10 requires school districts to train district staff and school board members on responding to a disclosure of child sexual abuse and complying with mandatory reporting requirements. Section 11 allows school districts and charter schools to accept funds from public and private sources for child sexual abuse prevention programs. Section 12 adds language providing that character development education is a shared responsibility and encourages districts to integrate character development instruction into positive behavioral intervention strategies. Section 13, this is from House File 1680, the Aaron's Law bill. It contains provisions relating child sexual abuse prevention education. And one change from the bill that we heard is that is subdivision 2. This one allows school districts to consult with other agencies and community organizations to identify tools, curricula, and programs rather than having the Department of Human Services do it. Section 14 modifies provisions on nationally normed college entrance exams. Districts are not required to, we're already not required to provide these, and this section changes requirements regarding the exams they're reimbursed for. It also modifies the definition of cultural competence. Section 15 modifies student categories for data reports. Section 16, again, that modifies student categories for growth reporting and requires that parents be notified about data reporting. Section 17 requires school districts to include in school performance reports certain information and calculate proficiency rates as required by the Every Student Succeeds Act. And it requires school districts to develop and post performance reports that comply with the world's best workforce requirements. Section 18 modifies open enrollment lotteries, gives priority to a new group of students based on whether their resident district operates a building in their municipality. Section 19 defines concurrent enrollment. That's from House File 1376. Sections 20 and 21 go together. It moves language that's in one, essentially just breaks it up into two sections. And those are, that's language relating to 9th and 10th grade students enrolling in concurrent enrollment. Section 22, enrollment priority. This eliminates limits on post-secondary institutions' ability to advertise or recruit high school students. Section 23 requires schools to allow students enrolled in a PSEO course to remain at the school during the school day, and it requires the schools to provide students reasonable access to computers during the school day for those classes. Section 24, this is a modification from the bill as it was heard. That was House File 1906. This requires a school board to adopt a policy regarding weighted grade point averages for students in dual enrollment courses. Section 25 increases the number of days the department has to pay post-secondary institutions for concurrent enrollment students. Section 26 prohibits discrimination by online learning program providers. Section 27 codifies, this was a session law from 2012 and 2014 that allowed innovative pilot projects, and that's now codified. Section 28 makes permanent a one-time provision that allowed certain early middle college program participants to remain enrolled until the student turns 22. Section 29. It does a couple of things. One is to recodify the requirement that charter schools comply with the Pupil Fair Dismissal Act. And it also regulates the placement of charter school students in the classroom of a teacher that is on a performance class or has not had a summative evaluation. Section 30 clarifies the admissions requirements that charter schools must abide by for the preschool programs. Section 31 modifies alternate instruction requirements for students that are unable to read at grade level by the end of kindergarten, first grade, or second grade. Section 32 allows e-learning days to be counted the same as days when schools are in session for purposes of calculating average daily membership. This connects back to the days of inclement weather when schools can provide online instruction. Section 33, Education Innovation Partners Cooperative Center, that was, I believe, Representative Metz's bill, and it extends the time that that program can spend the remaining grant money. Section 34, Southwest Minnesota State Special Ed Teacher Program, it broadens the program participants beyond special ed paraprofessionals. It includes other persons. Section 35 requires the Commissioner of Education to submit the department's ESSA plan to the legislature for approval before the plan is implemented. Section 36 contains appropriations. Section 37, another appropriation section with the mental health grants for the Intermediate School District and the Southwest Central Service Cooperative for mental health grants. And 38 is, Section 38 is our advisor instruction.
All right, any questions? And while we, before we go to you, Representative Devaney, just, we're trying to figure out why the feedback and the crackling, you can hear it. So if you have any electronics, can you move them away from the microphones or off the table if possible? We don't know what's causing it exactly, but trying to get to the bottom of it. All right, Representative Dabney.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And a question for Ms. Pera. The Section 18 on lotteries. I've read it a couple of times now, and I still don't get it. Can you explain it and help me understand it? I'm trying to make sense out of it, and I'm having trouble.
Sure.
Ms. Pera.
Yes. So currently, if a school district is doing open enrollment, it has a lottery. And there's already certain categories of students that will receive priority. For example, pull up the section here. If it's pursuant to an integration plan. So this adds a new category of students that would receive priority for the open enrollment category. And it's based on whether the municipality where the student resides, whether the school district that student is zoned for operates a building in that municipality. That's kind of the criteria that it's based on. Does that clarify it?
So, Madam Chair, is this the Edina Hopkins issue?
Yes, that's it.
Is this the St. Anthony Park issue that Representative Erdahl raised?
I don't believe so.
Oh, it doesn't look like it, based on the faces alone. All right, thank you.
Thank you. All right, other questions? Representative Mariani.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I wonder, Ms. Parr, if you tell us on Section 12, there's a character development section. Let me just get to that section really quickly here. Can you tell us, and if you don't know, we could circle back later, but what does it mean to put into state statute by Minnesota law, something is the shared responsibility of parents and members of the community? I get the responsibility with teachers because we have an accountability system. So I'm just wondering whether this is new language. I really don't know whether we've done this before. So I guess the question is this unique language, number one, and two, what does it mean in terms of, because it's our job to enforce laws?
Ms. Pera.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Representative Mariani, this is new language. Mm-hmm. There was already language in the statute encouraging districts to offer character education. This does add to that. This is from Representative Erickson's bill.
She's not here, but it's from the policy bill.
It is from the policy bill. And it is a bill that was heard in policy committee. But yes, this does add language to this section. I believe it was a pretty recent provision that was added to law, and this modifies it.
And Madam Chair,
Representative Mariani.
It's certainly unfair for me to ask you what the intent is. But so I guess the real question is, as far as you know, is this new language adding? Is this new language in terms of our statutory framework in the state, where we're identifying by law what the responsibility of a parent is? And we could continue this offline, but that's fine. It's just a curious, Madam Chair, it's a curious wording in state law.
Thank you, Representative Mariani. And we can, I guess, maybe I would ask Mr. Strom, too, as sort of the senior member of the nonpartisan team here, who's seen a lot, if you have any comments or any light to share on this issue. It seems to me that there are some references in our statutes to parent and community involvement, but I don't know if it's exactly mirrors what's in this policy bill.
Yeah, Madam Chair, Strong. Representative Mariani, we're looking for the provision. I believe there's a similar provision already in statute that's a little more general than character education. And of course, we won't speak to the intent of that, but we'll see if we can find that for you in the next minute or two here.
Thank you. Other questions? Any other questions on this one?
Madam Chair.
Oh, I have a question. Representative Moran, yep.
So I'm looking at Article 2, Number 3, Subdivision 2 plan. And in just looking at the what it requires the school board and charter schools to adopt a plan that includes accommodation for students who lack access to internet at home or digital devices and accessible options for children with disability. And I think the concept is good, but I'm just thinking the impact that it may have on schools. So is it like extra dollars to help them with this process, or is this something that schools are currently doing?
Ms. Pera.
Madam Chair, Representative Moran, this,
and I'm sorry, could you tell me which section that was again, or page in line from the DE?
It's on page 16, and it starts line 17.
Thank you.
This language is permissive, so school boards are not required to implement these days, these learning plans. This bill was heard in the Education Policy Committee. Let's see, this was from Representative Druskowski's bill. And we heard testimony from a school board that is doing this. School boards will have flexibility as to how to implement something like this if they choose to.
If they choose.
Thank you.
Thank you. Other questions? Representative Mariani?
Madam Chair, I apologize because I did have a question on the Article 1. Could I ask that now? Or?
Sure.
Okay. And so I think this would be to Mr. Strom, since he presented that this is Section 13 of Article 1. And it's the subdivision 5, lines 24 through 26. And this ties the MCA participation rate to compensatory revenue, access to compensatory revenue. And again, I don't want to ask the intent here. I just want to understand whether this language in your estimation supersedes or makes null, I think language we have, I think language we have elsewhere where parents have a right to not have their students participate in the MCAs. Is there a conflict with this two language, or are those, they're obviously a related issue, but is there, does this conflict with that, or is it not conflict?
Madam Chair, Representative Mariani, policy issues aside, I would say it does not conflict. The formula is simply saying that your revenue amount is reduced based on a characteristic, and that characteristic is what percent of the students take the test. There's nothing in the language in Subdivision 5 here that would require the child to take the test, so the parent's right to opt out still exists. The district's funding would be reduced because of that. But in my view, those in some way, while they may be related, there's no statutory or implementation problem with doing that. I don't think there's a conflict, whether, again, I won't speak to the policy, but no conflict in terms of the drafting on that.
Thank you.
All right. Not seeing any other questions at this moment, and I don't know if you found the other thing, Mr. Strom, otherwise we'll just keep moving on.
Yeah, let's, Madam Chair, please keep moving.
All right, so Article 3. Ms. Pera?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Article 3 is the teachers' article. This article modifies programs affecting teachers and includes changes to the process for unrequested leaves of absence. Section 1 is the teacher administrator administrator preparation and performance data report, and it requires these programs to report certain data disaggregated by race. The number and percent of students for each program graduated, received a license, and were hired, and also survey results measuring student graduate satisfaction with the program. Section 2, 3, 4, and 5, these all relate to alternative teacher preparation programs. Section 2 eliminates the requirement that a nonprofit entity that forms a partnership with a school district or charter school already had to offer one of these programs already have a board-approved teacher preparation program. It also eliminates the requirement that candidates have a bachelor's degree with a minimum grade point average to enter these programs. Section 3 eliminates the requirement that the program includes student teaching and replaces it with observed classroom experience. Section 4 eliminates language allowing the board, to establish criteria for approval, and instead it requires approval if the program meets the criteria. That's in the statute. Section 5 changes the reporting requirements from reports in 2013 and 2015 to an ongoing biennial report. Sections 6 and 7 both relate to negotiated unrequested leaves of absence. They require school board and the exclusive representative of the teachers to negotiate the unrequested leave of absence plan. So it removes the default language for placing teachers on unrequested leave of absence based on seniority. Section 8 and 9 go together. These are from House File 1376. Section 8 divides paragraph B into two paragraphs, so there is now paragraph C. None of the language is new. Section 9, it's on alternative teacher compensation revenue for the St. Croix River Education District, and it refers to paragraph C, which was previously part of B, so it clarifies that reference there. Section 10 defines positive behavioral interventions and supports as an evidence-based framework for preventing problem behavior, and it lists key components of PBIS. It also allows schools to use character education to support implementation of PBIS. Section 11 is an alternative teacher preparation grant program, and it defines certain terms like program and shortage area and unit. It also establishes the grant program for programs that fill teacher shortage area and specifies how these grants can be used. Sections 12, 13, and 14 relate to teacher shortage loan forgiveness program. Section 12 adds economic development regions where there is a shortage of teachers of color to the definition of teacher shortage area. And this is an issue that's in the address in the department's teacher supply and demand report. Section 13 expands teacher shortage loan forgiveness program to the eligibility to include teachers of color. And Section 14 expands the reporting requirement for the race to include race or ethnicity of teachers that are participating in the program. Section 15, statewide concurrent enrollment teacher training program. This expands a program that was established, I believe it was last session, to help teachers get the credits that they need, those 18 credits, so that they can teach the concurrent enrollment courses for post-secondary credit in the high school. And the program is expanded to include other associations within the state, and it opens up the program to teachers throughout Minnesota. Section 16, agricultural educator grants. It establishes a grant program to pay agricultural educators for summer work with high school students in extended programs. Section 17 is the appropriations, which I'll let Ms. Adrians walk you through. And Section 18, that's the repealer, and that again relates back to the unrequested leave of absence provisions.
All right, questions on Article 3? All right, not seeing any. Article 4, special education.
Madam Strong? Chair, members, Article 4 is the special education article. First section of this provision has to do with the cultural competency issues that this committee talked about briefly. Section 2 is from House File 1376, the governor's recommendation, and included in Representative Erickson's version of the bill that came to this committee. Section 3 is the issue regarding the Bar None facility in the St. Francis School District. Speaker Dowd was here to present that bill and essentially a clarification of how the non-resident tuition billing should work for the students who attend the ALC in St. Francis who are at the Bar None facility. Sections 4, 7, and, or 4, 6, and 7, rather, are Representative Thiessen's provisions related to the third-party reimbursement. Section 5 is from the House File 1376 and is clarifying the names. The department's hoping to use the term on-site education programs to separate the care and treatment from the facility itself, so it's clearer that the Departments of Human Services and corrections are actually, when they are talking about care and treatment, they're talking about the physical facility and the non-school program there. And then in the education parlance, the term on-site education program would refer to the program that's occurring there at the residential facility. Section 8 is from Representative Erickson's bill, House File 1376, and requires a study on special education assistive technology, its uses, and requires a report to the legislature by February 15th of next year. And Section 9 is the appropriations for this article, which Ms. Adrians will address when we get to the appropriations spreadsheet.
All right, any questions on Article 4? All right, not seeing any, let's move on to Article 5. Ms. Pera.
Thank you, Madam Chair, members. Article 5, Facilities and Technology, it addresses, it's largely the Purpose Center for Arts Education. Sections 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 7 are striking the Purpose Center from statutes that address other state agencies. So Sections 1 and 2 both relate to unclassified positions. Those are for state employees. Section 3 is the alternative teacher compensation revenue. Sections 4 and 5 relate to severance pay when the school boards enter into agreements for instruction of pupils in either another district or the students going to school in another state. Section 6 and These sections are from House File 1825 and 1826. Section 6 differs slightly from the House Files in that instead of having an arts education specialist, there's now arts education division within the Department of Education to provide art support services throughout Minnesota. Section 8 allows the Crosswind School to be conveyed for continued use as an East Metropolitan Area Integration School. Section 9 provides for the closure of the Purpich Center for Arts Education. Subdivision 1 provides that it would be abolished effective June 30th, 2018, and the other subdivisions relate to the transfer of the property in the library, student enrollment, and transfer of education records. Section 10 is the appropriation section, and Section 11 repeals statutes and rules related to the Purpich Center.
Questions on Article 5? All right, Article 6.
Madam Chair, members, Article 6 is the nutrition article in the bill. The first two sections deal with the authority of a school board to enter into a contract for food service. Essentially, what's happening here is that the opportunity for the...
I'm sorry, Mr. Strom, if you could suspend for a moment. Representative Thiessen.
We'll go through the spreadsheet later. Okay.
Thank you. All right, Mr. Strom.
Madam Chair, thank you. Representative Thiessen, I'm sorry, I wasn't looking up.
I apologize.
Article 6 is the nutrition article. There are two sections in addition to the appropriations section in this article that have to do with the length of time for a food service contract. And essentially what's happening is that the state contracting authority is going to the maximum allowed by the federal law, which is allowing the contract to be renewed for up to 4 additional years after the initial term ends. And when we get to the appropriations, Ms. Adrians will go through the tracking sheet on the changes in nutrition. Madam Chair, members, Article 7 is the library's article. The first section is the provision from Representative Erickson's bill that authorizes the Division of Library Services at the Department of Education to provide advice and guidance to school district and charter school libraries. And Section 2 is the appropriations for the regional and multi-county, multi-type library systems.
So questions on Article 6 or Article 7? All right, not seeing any. We'll move on to Article 8. Ms. Pera.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Article 8 is early childhood and family support. This article addresses early education, establishes the Director of Early Education Development, and appropriates money. Sections 1 through 8 all relate to the establishment of the Director of Early Education and Development. Sections 1 and 2 modify sections in Chapter 13. Section 1 provides that the director has access to educational data in accordance with another section that I'll address later. Section 2 provides the director access to human services data. Section 3 defines terms. This will be the first section in new Chapter 119C. So it has the definitions for the director and the early education programs that will be included in that will be recodified in Chapter 119C, school readiness, early learning scholarships, and Head Start. Section 4 is the policy. It states the policy and the purpose of establishing the Office of Early Education and Development. Section 5 relates to the Director of Early Education and Development. Subdivision 1 provides that the director will be appointed by the governor, and it requires the commissioner of administration to provide administrative services to the director. Subdivision 2 establishes the qualifications. Subdivision 3, the compensation in accordance to Chapter 15A. Subdivision 4 establishes the duty of the director, including setting policy for the programs under the director's jurisdiction and serving as executive director of the children's cabinet. It also requires the Commissioner of Education, Commissioner of Human Services, that they'll be directed by this new director. Subdivision 5 requires coordination with other agencies. including with respect to data. Subdivision 6 has data practices, and that provides the director access to certain educational data and data collected by the welfare system. Subdivision 7 requires an annual report by the director. Section 6, program administration, relates to activities that the director will undertake, including applying for federal funds, accepting donations, charging a sliding fee for the programs. Subdivision 3 requires the children enrolled in a program under Chapter 119C to receive a kindergarten readiness assessment. And Subdivision 4 requires that guarantees that a program in this chapter will receive at least the same funding in fiscal year 2018 and later as it did in fiscal year 2017. Section 7 requires the director to limit the maximum aid that a child can generate from a combination of programs. And that limit would be based on family income level. Subdivision 2 requires the director to reduce the aid to a child that generates the aid if it exceeds the limit, and there are exceptions to that in Subdivision 4. Subdivision 3 provides that federal Head Start aids are included in the aid limit. That the aid limit would be effective later and would not go into effect until 2019. Section 8 establishes early education resource hubs that the director would establish throughout the state. Section 9, long-term facilities maintenance revenue. There's a couple of provisions in here, a couple of sections of language. One strikes the voluntary pre-kindergarten program from the statute, and it also provides that a district that qualified for this revenue in 2010 remains eligible for fiscal year 2017 and later. Sections 10 and 11 both strike voluntary pre-kindergarten program from the statutes, first on program for the breakfast reimbursement and then from breakfast and lunch fees. Section 12 delinks the formula allowance for the early childhood family education programs from the basic formula allowance and increases the formula for fiscal years 2018 and 2019 and later. Section 13 allows a charter school or group of charter schools to establish school readiness program. Section 14 allows a charter school to receive aid for a school readiness program in the same manner as school districts, and also increases the total school readiness entitlement by $4 million in 2018 and by $5 million in fiscal year 2019 and later. Section 15 modifies the provision on the purpose of the early learning scholarships. Section 16 modifies the eligibility requirements for the scholarships. Section 17 prohibits the Commissioner of Education from designating scholarships for use in predetermined programs, which would eliminate the path, might eliminate the pathway to scholarships, and requires the Commissioner to give highest priority for scholarships to certain children. Section 18 postpones the date by which a program must have a 3 or 4 star rating to accept the early learning scholarship. Section 19 strikes the voluntary pre-kindergarten program from a statute relating to English learners. Section 20 education partnerships program establishes a program to support programs that provide support services in neighborhoods experiencing poverty, establishes 2 tiers of grants. Tier 1 is to maintain the operations of an existing program, and tier 2, those are grants, those are implementation grants to expand existing programs. Section 21 strikes the voluntary pre-kindergarten program from the statute on pupil units. Section 22 requires our report by the Commissioner of Human Services and the Commissioner of Education that requires a report on early education and child care programs. This was also from House File 2259, which establishes the Director of Early Education. Section 23 is appropriations to the Department of Education. Section 24 is appropriations to the Office of Early Education. And section 25 is instructions to the revisor to recodify the early education programs in chapter 119C. And section 26 repeals 124D, section 124D 151, which is the voluntary pre-kindergarten program.
Okay. Article 8, Representative Markwart.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. So the students currently in the pre-voluntary kindergarten, where does that go from there? I mean, is there a continue? Is it just what happens to those students in those schools who have qualified for that in the past?
Madam Chair, Representative Markwart, that cohort of students essentially would be moving into kindergarten next year, and then the district would no longer have a funded program for the next cohort of four-year-olds through the voluntary pre-kindergarten program.
Okay.
Representative Markwart.
Yeah, Madam Chair. So I know they've been applying already for the recent, how are the current, so those who have been applying, what happens? The applications just, that process just stops? Or what happens next on that?
Madam Chair, Representative Markwart, perhaps when the department testifies on the bill, they'll address this as well. It's my understanding that the department used the same list of applicants as for last year in order to make the recommendations for the coming year in terms of the number of students served. The language when the bill passed last year set a dollar cap to be spent on that program. And so I believe that that's the list that's being used so that the districts are being made aware as the next fiscal year is coming as to what where they'd be on that list in terms of under the dollar cap. And then it's my understanding that if the program were to continue, a new list would be used for fiscal 19 and later.
Okay, but Madam Chair, so but if this becomes law, then notification would come out to those schools that have applied for this next year. They would say this no longer exists. Is this what would occur?
Madam Chair, Representative Markwart, yes.
Okay. Well, Madam Chair, and I we've got school districts now that have kind of, you know, this was a program that I think almost everyone who was here last year voted for and supported. And now, as schools start ramping this up and putting it into their curriculum and into their structure and so forth, we're going to kind of yank the rug right out from under them. And I guess, I don't know. It looks to me like sometimes we try to prove some points here and not necessarily for the good of the students. And I just think if you're looking at a program like this, you could at least notify schools and give them some time. I mean, some of these schools have invested in setting up these programs for this year. I mean, they've had to find space and all those other things. And, you know, they certainly can continue a program on their own. But, you know, there's kind of when the state ends up investing in something, and it was something that was approved by strong bipartisan support, if I remember the education bill last year. Was that in the supplemental?
It was in the supplemental bill, yeah. Representative Markwart. So there wasn't a separate vote on the voluntary pre-K funding that was put in that supplemental. So, you know, I don't.
I agree. But, I mean, Madam Chair, I mean, superintendents, and you wonder sometimes why superintendents and school boards just kind of shake their heads because they do something one year. And this is major stuff, starting pre-voluntary pre-K. It's not it's part of the K-12. I mean, this was pretty new stuff.
Part of the grade 12. It was grade 4-year-old as it was created.
Yeah, no, that's correct. But, I mean, it's something relatively new, and here they're gearing up for it, and the state does it for one year, and now it's gone. I just think it does not set up a real good relationship between the state and our school districts and school boards. And, you know, one of the things, when you look at the data on preschool, one of the important things, if you're going to sustain the growth into, you know, first, second, and third grade, is continuity of programs. And it seems like in early childhood education here the last 2-3 years has just been kind of back and forth. And actually, maybe the point in here, Madam Chair, where you're trying to bring everything together is I think maybe going to bring some more consistency. I think that is good. But I think to pull out a huge, kind of a pretty big component of this, and one that districts, I know a lot of them are excited about and planning ahead in that, and to have it for 1 year now to just yank it out from under them is not the best way to get our kids prepared for kindergarten. So I'll leave it at that for right now, but I do think you wonder why superintendents and that are school boards come here and just kind of wonder, you know, what's going to happen next, and they can never properly plan into the future on what they're going to do, and consistency for student growth in that is so important. So I don't think this is moving in the right direction, but I know we'll have further discussion on that. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Representative Marquardt, and I'm sure we will. And I know this kind of gets to probably some philosophical and other differences about how we go about providing early childhood education for students who, again, are identified as falling into the achievement or the opportunity gap. And so, you know, the state kind of started down the pathway of awarding it through scholarships. And then we've had other venues created sort of over top of that. And that's been a concern of this chair for a while, that we've kind of started down the pathway one way and then moved it over here. You know, clearly I prefer the scholarship and the school readiness model that we have now, and this bill reflects that. But I do expect that there'll be members with other opinions on that, and we'll continue to have that discussion as this process works its way through. So, thank you. Representative Mariani.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And I have a couple of technical questions because, you know, I understand right now we're primarily engaging with staff for understanding the technical application. However, just a quick comment on that last back and forth. I frankly don't like being put in a position of choosing between scholarships and a public delivery system. And frankly, I don't think most Minnesotans want to be put in that position either. But we'll have that debate in the coming day. So, Madam Chair, to staff on Article 8, Section 5, under the duties of the director of the Early Education and Development Subdivision 4, there's the director must develop early education program policies, and the director must establish the aid limits under Section 119C.05. I just want to be clear, does any of this set up rulemaking authority for the director relative to the carrying out of these duties?
Ms. Para.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Representative Mariani. This statute does not set up rulemaking authority for the director. The director will direct the Commissioner of Education as to how to manage the education programs. And the Commissioner of Education has rulemaking authority.
Representative Mariani.
Thank you, Madam Chair. That's helpful. It's a clarification. And then to that last point about directing the Commissioner of Education, so that's on line 101.29. Is that something that exists elsewhere in statute, where we have someone who's not a commissioner directing a commissioner to do things like rulemaking consistent with the duties that they're being charged with? And if you don't know the answer to that, we could circle back at some point to get that.
Ms. Para, and I'm just thinking, trying to remember the school trust lands position. Would that be similar?
Madam Chair, the school trust land is a similar position in that it's not exactly in the Department of Education, but has some authority.
Representative Mariani.
Well, Madam Chair, I think it's worth the discussion about someone directing a commission appointed by the governor to carry out duties. Including, I think, triggering that department's ability then to do rulemaking. It seems, at least at the very least, unorthodox, and I think we should carefully talk that through. I want to ask on page 110 on Article 8, Section 19, Subdivision 2, English learner. As I read that language, and I understand that in the bill we have the elimination of the voluntary pre-K program. And so I'm thinking all that language means, since we're eliminating VPK in this bill proposal, that all this language means is that for that, in, how do I say this? That removing an English learner as a pupil who is in a pre-K program really only applies to the VPK program. What I'm getting at here, Madam Chair, is that I believe that there are at least opportunities of not mandates in EL and the ESSA accountability, federal accountability system, relative to EL students who are pre-K. And so I think I understand what this does, but I just want for the record to be sure that all we're talking about here is the identification of English language learners who are pre-K as they relate to the Minnesota VPK program, but not to any other early childhood program that we have. Is that correct?
That's correct, but I'll turn to Mr. Strom to confirm.
Madam Chair, Representative Mariani, yes, that's correct. The issue essentially with VPK is by calling the student a pupil and including a pupil weight for that student, all of the definitions of pupil then essentially include that student, and that child's considered enrolled at that age. So removing this puts the statute back how it was before last year's changes, and the district certainly is allowed to provide services as it sees necessary through programs like its existing school readiness program. But the definition of pupil that was used here was explicit to draw in the VPK pupils, and there were also issues related to that regarding to the timelines. If you look on the following page, 111.19, as you know, the English learner formula only covers 7 years of service. And so there was a section specifically addressing on lines 111.25 and 111.26, addressing that. But that's really only, all of those changes are really only about the definition of the pupil now changing so that the early learning four-year-olds aren't considered a pupil. They can still be students in other programs there, but they're not an enrolled pupil, as it were.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Representative Dabney.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And I'm looking at Article 8, Section 6, specifically page 102, lines 24 through 31, and where it starts on, I guess, 25 through 31, where it starts on 25 and 26, saying this director may only access private data related to an individual's participation, and then lists the programs. So what private data am I giving over to the director if my child is in a school readiness program, kindergarten readiness program, an early learning scholarship program, a Head Start program, or CCAP funded program?
Thank you, Representative Dabney. Ms. Pera.
Thank you, Madam Chair, Representative Dabney. I would have to look up the definition of private data, but any private data that the Department of Education has relating to participation in that program, whether it would include date of birth and income and all of the private data that that the families provide when they're applying. There is a provision in here requiring that the parents be notified that they are providing access to that data, and that's on page 103 on line 2. I'm sorry, that one states that the director can only provide access to the private data when the parent has consented, under subdivision 5, paragraph C, and that's the paragraph that has some more information about the data that's being shared and the consent form.
All right. Thank you, Ms. Pera. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Representative Thiessen.
Thank you, Madam Chair. My question is on the subdivision 13. On the Tier 1 and Tier 2 grants for the community partnerships.
Do you have a page on that?
118, sorry.
All right.
And it basically dedicates all the money to the five existing groups, but doesn't leave any room. As I'm reading it, I just want to clarify for organizations like Austin Aspires and the folks in Grand Rapids who are moving down this path.
That's correct.
Okay. I'd like to see if we can talk about that one a little bit. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for including it, though.
Yes. Other questions? All right. Article 9.
Madam Chair, members, Article 9 is the Community Education and Prevention article. There are no statutory language changes, just an appropriations section that Ms. Adrians will talk about.
All right, and Article 10.
Madam Chair, members, Article 10 is the Self-Sufficiency and Lifelong Learning article. This article addresses adult basic education in Section 1. Under current law, that program has a built-in growth factor of 3% per year. This bill is lowering that growth factor to 1% per year for the adult basic education programs. The remaining sections of this article are from Representative Jessup's bill related to the general education diploma being broadened so that the state considers an alternative equivalency test for high school equivalency. And there's an appropriations section in Section 6 that Ms. Adrians will address.
Thank you. Questions on Article 10? All right, Article 11.
Madam Chair, members, Article 11 is the state agencies article. The first eight sections of this article are similar to language that was carried in last year's House bill. These sections essentially take the fees that are paid by teachers when they are licensed and administrators when they're licensed and put them into an account in the special revenue fund. Currently, those fees go into the general fund. This provision essentially would require those fees all to go into the special account, and then the organizations like the Board of Teaching or its successor organization and the Board of School Administrators would be funded out of those fees instead of out of the general fund. And Ms. Adrians will talk about the way the appropriations are actually working, but in terms of those statutory sections, what they do is set up this account in the special revenue fund for educator licensure.
Thank you. And that's it, right?
Madam Chair, yes.
Any questions for Mr. Strom or Ms. Pera before we turn to Ms. Adrians to walk through the spreadsheet? All right, Ms. Adrians, if you want to walk us through the spreadsheet, please.
Thank you, Madam Chair and members. Before I dive in, I should say that I was kind of proud of myself for my first shot at the big K-12 spreadsheet, but sitting here, I already found one error. So you will probably find some mistakes. I have to ask for your forgiveness ahead of time. And then I also wanted to make mention of a few things just to note as you go through it. We have not received an updated, detailed view of the governor's recent recommendations. So what is in here currently for the governor's recommendations are the January recommendations that were based on the November forecast. So I believe you all have information about how that changed, but I just wanted to make a note of that. And then just to orient you a little bit, I'll go through it, but a shortcut way, if you're looking to find the change items, at the very top, if you can see, I have a few of the columns labeled A, B, C, D, and so these are for our current planning purposes for the 18-19 biennium. If you look at column D, this will show you all of the, if there's a positive or a negative number in this column, that means that that is a change item. And so for the most part, I am just going to go over the change items, but I'm happy to answer any other questions that you might have. So for the first area for the Gen Ed program, this is the numbers at the very top on row 4, where it's the basic formula amount. This is where you can see the proposal of the increase of 1.5% each year. It changes the per pupil number from $6,067 to $6,158 in the first year and $6,249 in fiscal year 19. And then that number stays steady. On row 10, this is the amount of the basic formula allowance increase. It starts off at almost $275,000 for the change. The way that was offset is a couple of programs were.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Can we just clarify that 121 you have for the basic formula increase should actually be 91?
Line 5.
Oh, yeah. Well, good. I'm glad you're already helping me fix my mistakes.
That was just to catch our attention.
To make sure you're paying.
Focus us.
Yeah, my apologies, Madam Chair.
That's
members.
Correct. In fact, Ms. Adrians, can you give us the correct numbers for those?
Yes, they should each be a $91 increase. And so I am certain, Madam Chair and members, that this was just because I was copying and pasting. So the governor's increases, I believe, are the 121 and 124. And so the top line, the 6,158, those numbers are correct, but the increase, rather, is $91, I believe, for each.
Thank you.
Thank you. Like I said, members, that might not be the only mistake you find. Okay, so, and that number shouldn't affect any of my other numbers. So the increase in the formula allowance is almost $275,000, and that was offset by delinking a couple of programs that would regularly automatically increase with the formula increase, and rather than increase, they will just remain at the previous amount. So the first one is the compensatory is delinked, the non-public pupil aid, the non-public pupil transportation. So those are the next three lines. The provision that provides for extended time, compensatory, that Mr. Storm and Ms. Perra went over in the bill.
Representative Thiessen.
Sorry. So the delinking, is that indefinite in the future, or is that just for this biennium?
Mr. Storm.
Madam Chair, Representative Thiessen, that would go on forever. That's not just this biennium.
Madam Chair and members. The 24 million dollars that's for the extended time, the compensatory program, and then underneath that, this is the provision that provides for the extended time for the Prairie Lakes, the Wilmer area, and then hold on, I'm getting a little bit okay, and then on line 17. This is the voluntary pre-K repeal. There, you'll find there are a couple of provisions or areas rather throughout the bill where you will see an amount that is reduced. And I think on all of them, I put a notation next to it that says VPK repeal so that you know why the reduction is made. This is the largest sum, and this affects the general education line, and so it's a reduction of $41 million in the biennium. On line 18, this was Representative Lee's bill to provide for graduation incentives. And then that is it for the top part of the general education line. The only change under the remainder of the general education provisions, it's on line 33, and this is the existing compensatory pilot project, but it's providing for an increase in funds to the amount of almost $6.9 million in the biennium. Under education excellence, this is where we're going to find a number of changes to some of the different grant programs. On line 42, there's a reduction to achievement and integration, and this is as a result of the repeal of the voluntary pre-K program. The next line, 43, this is the agricultural educators provision, $250,000 of one-time money. Let's see. On line 45, this is the alternative teacher preparation. It's another one-time amount of $1 million. On line 47, the civics education doesn't receive a change in this current biennium, but in the TAILS, the funding is eliminated. On line 48, the Q program, it's an additional, so it's adding $440,000 onto their base.
Representative Thiessen.
Thank you, sorry, Madam Chair. So the civics education, so we added civics, well, citizenship as a social studies assessment requirement. So, well, how is that different than the civics education?
Madam Chair and members, if I may, I think the civics education, it has to do with like YMCA, a couple of YMCA programs and some of those. This, it's not the same as the social studies.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
And I should have mentioned this before, but I tried, if it was a change item, I also tried to put the program name in italics. Just, I know it's a big spreadsheet, so I'm trying to think of ways to make it easier to read. So on page two, the next change item, the Education Innovation Partners. This is one of the bills, I believe we have three of them, where we canceled an amount of funding in 2017 and then reappropriated it in 2018. And this was done just so they could have an extension of their one-time funds. So this does not come as a cost to the committee's target. On line 53, this is additional funding for the paraprofessionals program, Grow Your Own. It's an additional $1 million to their base funding. On line 58, this is, it's one time for the biennium, so $4.9 million will go to the intermediate school districts for mental health purposes. It's in here right now, but this will be a transfer out of the area. On line 60, Math Corps received an additional $500,000 to their base funding. On line 62, the Minnesota Center for the Book, I believe this was Representative Murphy's bill. So it's $100,000 in one-time spending for the current biennium. On line 64, the museums and educational centers. So in addition to the base, this was adding on the Southwest Minnesota Children's Museum for $50,000 a year. And that's the one that is in Mankato, I believe. On line 67, it's the print adding to the principal academy's base funding, adding $100,000. On line 68, this is a removal of funding for the race to reduce water conservation grants. On line 69 for Reading Corps, it's an additional $1 million for their base budget. Line 71, the Rock and Read, this is a singing-based pilot. It's a one-time appropriation of $500,000. On line 72, the Santa Foundation, it's another one-time grant of $1 million for the biennium. On line 75, this is another one of those cancellations where they just wanted an extension of their funds to have a little more time to use them. So it's taking the amount of money that they would not have spent by the end of the year, $253,000, and then extending it. And it will actually be available for them to spend through the entire biennium. On line 77, the Starbase STEM program, again, it's the same. They asked to carry forward, I believe it was upwards of $800,000. And so that's being added to their base amount for 2018. And then because of having all that funding, they did not receive any funding in 2019, but then their base goes, it goes back to its regular level in 2020. If you will go down to line 85, line 84. This is the teacher shortage loan forgiveness, and it's $4 million in one-time money. And then on line 93.
Madam Chair.
Oh, Representative Thiessen.
Just before we leave this section, one general question. Did you have a TAILS target?
Yes.
Do we know what that is?
Yes, but I don't recall, Ms. Adrians.
Yeah, you could just let us know.
Madam Chair and Representative Thiessen, I focus much more on the current biennium's target to make sure that we meet that, and that's what will be in. I don't believe they've come out with it, but the budget resolution that will be in Ways and Means later today. So we do pay attention to the TAILS target, and I will check and see if I have that number.
Okay, just because there's one-time funding, that's kind of a tip on a little bit, but it'd be nice to know what that is. And then on line 85, the tribal contract schools, just so I understand that, we had one time, a pretty significant bump of one-time money in the last biennium. So they've been up, well, the governor's budget is continuing that one-time money, but this budget is now cutting that back. So those tribal contract schools are actually going to have much less money in the next biennium than they had this current biennium.
Mr. Strom.
Madam Chair, Representative Thiessen, yes, we generally measure toward base, but in terms of your question, they'll have had more money in last biennium because the formula was $3,500, not $1,500, times the pupil units served at the four tribal contract schools.
Representative Murphy.
On 977, and did that allow for the expansion to Northeast Minnesota?
Representative Murphy, I'll let nonpartisan staff answer, but it was my understanding that that money that they wanted to carry over unspent would allow them to do that expansion, and they were waiting on federal appropriations that they were anticipating coming through, but just to confirm my recollection.
Madam Chair and Representative Murphy, that's my understanding as well.
Okay. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Okay, so we're at, I'm sorry, at line 85 was where we were?
Yes, Madam Chair and members. And then if you'll move down to line 93, this is a reduction that reflects a change in the language as to the people that the bill is directing school districts to provide reimbursement for to take the ACT test. So the intent is to have a savings of $3 million. If you'll go to the next page. For charter schools, for the building lease aid, this the reduction of $291,000 is a result of the repeal of voluntary pre-K. Under the special ed programs on line 108, this is also a result of the voluntary pre-K repeal. Otherwise, the special education program remains, the funding is steady at base. Under facilities and technology, the long-term maintenance equalization aid, the reduction of $121,000 is a result of the voluntary pre-K repeal. Under nutrition programs, school lunch and school breakfast are both reduced $102,000 and $180,000 because of the voluntary pre-K repeal. And if you'll go to the next page. Starting on line 154 under the Family and Early Childhood Programs, school readiness is increased by $8.5 million in the first biennium, and then that is added to the base, so it's $9.8 million in the second biennium. The early learning scholarships, the funding is increased by $24.6 million, and that's base funding. ECFE has an increase in funding of just under $1 million. The parent-child home program has an additional $1 million added to the base funding. If you will look further down, starting on line 174, these are the Northside Achievement and St. Paul Promise and the rest of the Education Pilot and Transformation Zone expansion. So for the St. Paul Promise and the NAS, they both receive an additional $100,000 per year for their funding. So that brings them up to $1.3 million for their base. And then the $963,000 for the biennium is for the additional sites. ABE, this reduction in funding on line 180 is a result of changing the growth rate from 3% down to 1%. And then if you'll go to the next page. This is the beginning of the state agency budgets. And for the Department of Education, the first change line is a general reduction to the agency, and this amount is about $1.5 million, and a portion of it is for the voluntary pre-K repeal of their administrative funds for it. The regional centers, this is an elimination of that funding. It's $2 million for a biennium. The next line is the elimination of the school safety tech center, and that is just funded in this biennium, so that's $1 million of one-time funding. And then this is the implementation of the Perpich Arts Education Outreach Person for $400,000 for the biennium. On line 207, this is the Board of Teaching. And then the bill that's House File 140 is not in this current bill right now, but it's traveling on its own. But the agreement of, because we didn't have a proper fiscal note, so we took the appropriation out of that bill, and but this committee is paying for it out of the committee target. So this is, we still don't have a completed, really, really good fiscal note, but these are the best estimates at this point in time. So this number may change a bit as well. All of the other agencies, the Minnesota State Academies are base funding. This on line 217, this is the Office of Early Education and Development for the director. And this actually, it will be a transfer to the Department of Administration. So I'll try to make a note of that. On line 219 for Perpich. So the funding in for 2018 is their appropriation. It's less $1.9 million. And then the Department of Administration funds are that line on 224 for its $162,000 in 2018. It's to begin the process of selling the property. So this would be for like hiring a realtor and marketing supplies and whatnot. And then in the numbers that you see in the 2019 column, there's a line for severance payments and other required payouts for when an agency is closed. And then in the tails, it's just a removal of the appropriation for the agency. And so members, if you'll go to the last page. So the revenues and transfers section on line 237, this is for the provision of conveying crosswinds. This is an estimated amount for what might be what that conveyance might bring about. And then the line that says fiscal year 17 cancellation carry forwards, that's a total of the bills that we talked about where we were canceling their money in 2017 so that they could have it appropriated in 2018. And then for the closing of the Perpich Center, there are a number of transfers that would occur from a special revenue and a gift fund. And so those totals add to our spending total. So you can see on line 251, this is our total net spending of all of the provisions. And this is the amount of the target that the committee received for 2018-19. So it's about $18.53 billion for the biennium.
Representative Thiessen.
Thank you. Going back to line 237, Madam Chair. So the conveyance of crosswinds, that's an estimate of what we would sell it for?
Correct.
And Madam Chair, and that is because it is a school of the state agency or because we have bonding clause into it?
I don't know how to describe that. Mr.
Yeah, like
Strong.
Bird claws, yes.
Madam Chair, Representative Thiessen, it's my understanding that essentially that money would be deposited in the general fund, so there'd be essentially a savings to the state that this committee is then spending of an estimated $10 million should the crosswind site be purchased for that amount of money.
And Madam Chair?
Representative Thiessen.
And that $10 million then is going, that pays for other spending in the bill, so we're counting this in this budget? They're nodding yes, okay.
Madam Chair, yes.
And Madam Chair, yeah, that's a good question. What about the sale of the perpage? That was listed. So, well, no, that's not, you haven't accounted for any proceeds from the sale of perpage.
Ms. Adrian.
Madam Chair and Representative Thiessen, the fiscal note for the perpage bill is also still being worked on. And so they have not come up with an estimate yet as to what that might bring. And the idea is that the sale of that might not occur until 2020 or 2021.
Right.
So I believe that would be in the tails. And then, Madam Chair, if I may, the target that we received for our tails was about $314,000 above the base.
Million.
Million.
Or I'm sorry.
Okay. Okay.
Million, thousand.
And Madam Chair, just to come back to the conveyance. So if this is to be, does that mean that we're closing Crosswinds? I mean, does this assume that we close Crosswinds, or does this mean like if we were to sell it or send it over to St. Paul Schools that they would have to pay us for the building?
Representative Thiessen, I'll take that one. Obviously this is all still a discussion in progress. There are actually two school districts as of this morning interested in the Crosswinds, and they are both considering a purchase price for Crosswinds.
Okay.
Representative Dabney.
Madam Chair, that just begs the question. So are we selling it to the highest bidder? How is the decision going to be made as to who, which district takes over Crosswinds and operates it towards what end?
Well, Representative Dabney, I think the answer to your first question would be no. I mean, it'll still be subject to whatever the legislature approves legislatively. Yes, we've talked about this a couple of times. Legislatively, there has to be statutory language that's approved and signed into law conveying the property wherever it would be conveyed to. But for our purposes, inquiries have been made as to whether interested school districts would be willing to pay something for the school district, and so far no one has said no.
All right.
Thank you.
May I ask Ms. Adrian's a question?
Yes.
Thank you. Ms. Adrian, thank you for this. It's very understandable, so I appreciate that very much. I am trying to understand the shifts within the budget, and so if I look to understanding the elimination of the voluntary pre-kindergarten program and to assess the total shift within the bill from the elimination of that, am I right that I work down column D and add together lines 11, 12, 13, 17, 42, 99, 108, 117, 131, 132, and 200 to arrive at a complete number, accounting?
Madam Chair and Representative Dabney, I think you have the right idea. It's not line 11. It is actually line 17 is the voluntary pre-K repeal. But yes, that should work. And if you'd like, I could provide a separate document that might help too.
Representative Dabney.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and thank you, Ms. Adrian. Thank you for the catch on line 11, my scribbling. What about line 199? You'd made a comment, I think, about part of that is related to the voluntary pre-K elimination and implied at least that part of it wasn't, and so how do I assess that, or did I misunderstand you?
Ms. Adrians.
Madam Chair and Representative Dabney, I believe, I'm working off my memory, but the amount that the Department of Education was to use for administration of voluntary pre-K, I believe it was $513,000 for each year.
Right. Thank you, Ms. Adrian. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Madam Chair.
All right. Other questions for Ms. Adrian's or for other nonpartisan or for the chair? Okay. So, all right, so I think because we're 7 minutes away, we'll just wait and go to public testimony tomorrow, rather than maybe take one or two and then suspend. So again, Ms. Keynes went and double checked, and we did say noon tomorrow, so noon Thursday for amendments. And Mr. Kenny just informed me that as amendments are submitted, we will go ahead and post them online, so we won't wait until noon tomorrow. We'll just post them as we receive them, so members will have maximum opportunity to see what's being proposed. And we will be convening at 10 a.m. So we'll be meeting tomorrow, regular committee time at 1 o'clock, for public testimony. We do have the committee room reserved in the evening as well, so we can resume and take public testimony. I'd like to allow ample time for people to provide their comments. And then we will be convening at 10 a.m. on Friday morning in this room, regular room, to do the amending process and completing our action in this committee on the bill. All right, any questions from members? Is clear on that? All right, if not, committee is adjourned. Thank you.